Hi everyone, welcome again to the Al-Madina track. The second session, for the second session, we will have Antoine Krask and Ivan Sench. They both come from Leiria, and they are going to talk us about the road to production ready Kubernetes applications. Hi guys, very really nice to have you here.
Hello.
Hello.
How are you doing?
Yeah. Okay.
So let's see what production-ready Kubernetes applications are like.
Yeah, exactly. And maybe not only application. We'll talk not only about application, in fact. But yeah. Thank you, Bruno.
Okay.
Yeah. So welcome to everyone. Very happy to be there with Yvan for the GNation. So what we want to share with you today, it's a concrete experience and what we can learn from our experience and what we could apply for other experiences and I would say other organizations that are trying to adopt Kubernetes and more globally changing application to the cloud native paradigm. So three keywords for today is how we approached the topic, what was our experience in the various facets, and we'll see there are various facets and not only a technological one. And what can we learn from this experience? So just a small disclaimer, and I think it's probably one key messages of any changes we want to achieve in organization is that it can start okay with a very good architectural vision and what we want to solve for the business, and it should start there. But at the end of the day, if we want to reach and implement changes, it's with people, individual, and teams we need to convince and change. So even if today we are sharing with Yvan and me, but it's globally a work of a team and not only of some individuals. So just we will pass you some exhaustive bio. We had an approach of just a small hashtag way to describe what we like and what we are about. And I think we are both happy to be there to share and learn with the community globally. And we are all, at least with Yvan, I know we are passionate about engineering, cloud, Kubernetes, DevOps, and all this type of buzzword. We are probably with common interest. So I think this big picture is something we always need to keep in mind what we are trying to do. And a personal conviction I have is the power of capabilities for companies to be really supporting the business transformation and business innovation capability. So a big objective we had, we did some talks in the past of Redoute transforming from a low to a high performer using the DevOps paradigm of culture, organization, process, and tools. And we had another challenges to reach, and we are still inside this transformation today of moving from a high to an elite performer on these key metrics. And Kubernetes was one of the possibilities and one of the necessary technology and capabilities we have to create to sustain this type of performance for our organization. So basically, anything we want to do normally, and especially with companies, if someone wants to use their money, it's normally to solve a problem. So what was our problem, in fact, is we need to deliver new features for our customers, and we don't even know if they will like it or not. It's all part of the iteration and testing we need to do. So we start with this problem, and at some point, a developer has to develop something. But normally, what was happening for us is that we had a lot of troubles and pain points from a developer perspective. So you have some examples here that are quite typical, but they are really a pain point and all slowing down our rhythm of innovation for the team. And we see that all those phrases and sentences are not producing value at the end of the day for companies. So our core problem was not necessarily to say we need infinite scaling with cloud and Kubernetes, etc. It was to accelerate the business, and Kubernetes was one of the pieces in the game to change that. And we had a big question to answer each time, and that I was personally very frustrating. So I put 1 million, but it can be maybe 1 billion question for some companies. We have some concrete cases where we just need to change a simple function for the business, but we last days and weeks. due to all the organizational problem we have in the middle and technological one. And it's very important for us that we keep this in mind, because if we implement Kubernetes, we can make things quite more complex and in the end slower. And our objective at the end was to be able to ship simple changes, smaller, even more faster than what we are doing. And it was it's very key to keep that in mind through all the implementation. We can very quickly implement very nice and beautiful things, but be slower than initially. So be very counter at the initial objective. So what we share today in terms of Kubernetes and the cloud native application containers, etc., it's inserted into a global architectural and IT transformation we had to do. So we passed a lot of time to move from the monolith to a distributed, first microlith, then SOA, and then a bit more or distributed macroservices architecture, still powered on, I would say, IaaS and VMs infrastructure. Still, we are already using a bit of cloud, and we started to build a much more distributed application with fine-grained functions in a microservice paradigm. And at that time, we didn't. VMs was not supporting the necessary scalability and fast deployment we required. So why we went to Kubernetes? We passed a lot of time evaluating some solution, etc. But the key messages, I think, is we had to leverage Kubernetes for the functions that are there, because in fact, the containers by itself does not provide all the benefits an orchestrator can provide. So I think the key one we can see here is the self-service part, self-healing capability, orchestration, and also the portability part for provisioning and deployment was something important for us to don't be locked in with a particular provider. So, and just to share in our context is, nowadays, we can be old school if we are not using a public cloud. What are you doing? You are very late. But when we started to look at Kubernetes in 2018, and at that time, for a majority of organizations, especially in Europe, that are somebody with a bit of lag with US, we were all like, yeah, cloud, but how we will manage cost, and maybe it's very risky, and what will impact with our data, etc. So we were at that stage. And a second important point is that there was not already a big shift in the ecosystem towards, okay, it's Kubernetes, the de facto standard, etc. It was quite talked about, but there was still Docker Swarms and other competitors there. And then we started in parallel to have 2019 an emerging maturity in the cloud adoption, etc. And at that time, Kubernetes became de facto adopted, and we also made our choice there in 2019. And we continued this adoption through the way. And the last key message on this context, I think, so I put DevOps investment, but it can be a technological investment or continuous automation, etc. There is no one-shot change we can do in organization for technological. I think we can only invest over mid to long term to create real lasting capabilities. How we approached the Kubernetes adoption? So we followed, I would say, standard maturity approach. So we had the first step of exploration with a limited set of actors involved a bit in the R&D mode in 2018. But still, we involved stakeholders from the starter, including CIO, CTO, and other type of role in the company. And we had to answer key questions, starting with the basic: what is Kubernetes? What can it do for us, really? Which type of application can we ship inside? And to the contrary, which application we have makes no sense to try to deploy in Kubernetes. And we had a lot with lacking externalization of configuration and that type of stuff, for example. It was also the opportunity to judge and have a better vision of the effort to learn Kubernetes and everything that gravitate around Kubernetes. And we had to answer at the end, is it the right moment or not to do this type of investment and change? So once we did these phases, we decided to use Kubernetes, and there we moved to the second phase, which is a tactical one. And here we selected one team, in fact, when we started, involving a business, a product management, and a whole conception team, etc. And we take a topic that was sufficiently valuable, but not too risky. So we didn't take a strategic project, and we implemented it and show the value. And we had really here to show, are we faster or not? What can it provide, etc. And then, so we iterated then on specific tactical projects until we reached the implementation of a strategic one last year, with a much more larger scale of implementation.
Okay.
So, and I will let Yvan share a bit, start with the first things first, is before doing something, what is the end result we are aiming for? Yeah, so
yeah, that's right. They define the production reg. So what you are you trying to achieve, you know, for your goals is a better business application, a happy developer experience, reliable operation, you know, a better user experience in the keys, acceleration of applications, self-service for the developer guys, you know, to deliver that guys one application you want to deploy the large Kubernetes, you know, an operation with more security and metrics, so that you are archives, okay? Slides, please. Okay, for whom? The first thing you define some goals, you know, and for developing team, infrastructure teams and monitor teams, because the first thing you deliver your Kubernetes to the developer team, you know, and you need to get the information inputs from the developer team to improve your service. Okay, so in that case, you see the technical level of each guys you use the Kubernetes, you know, and try to figure out some help that guys use the Kubernetes, you know. The first thing for developer guys, you create some templates, in that case, in the Helm charts, to help that guy to develop, to deploy applications inside the Kubernetes. Continuous integration, continuous delivery process, you can deploy it as well, you know, and some applications to give more understandable inform of your Kubernetes clusters, okay? And for the operation, the monitor team, you create a step-by-step help maintainability process to give that guys some introduction to the Kubernetes, how you can do the things at the Kubernetes, and how you can, for example, do some recovery actions or fix some issues, you know? So you create some step-by-step documentation, a basic step-by-step documentation to that guys. And for the infrastructure guys, you create and define some models and standards we use in Terraform, you know, to help the deploy the Kubernetes inside the cloud provider. You know, in that case, you are using Google, and to help the infrastructure guys to maintain and give you more security and maintain the stability of your projects. Okay, next slide, please. What's your requirement? When you decide to accelerate your business transformation with Kubernetes, you question yourself if how you do this, you know? And in that case, you need to understand the business roadmap and develop roadmap, you know? And that after that, you can create some business process for SRE and DevOps guys, you know? And you can, for example, design a monitor process because you already have a monitor infrastructure implemented inside the La Redoute, you know? And for deploying cloud objects, CICD integration, and the Kubernetes support application. When I talk about Kubernetes support application, I talk about applications. You help the business application to do the job, okay? Like Prometheus, Monitor, Vault, Elasticsearch, or the external of the Kubernetes, for example, use the Kafka, or some databases you are using outside the Kubernetes. Integration with ITSCM service to do the things when you have some issues or requests at the Kubernetes, you know. So what you do that things, you know, for what? And what we require for that? So that's the process you use to define what you need to configure your Kubernetes to be a production ready. Next slide, please. Okay. Key design consideration for developer experience. for application for a platform. In that case, the most be able to ship fast and develop productions is controlled environments, the application development. And operation is developed responsibility, you know, and your goals reach 100% self-service integration with high level and SLAs and security, you know, that's your goals, that's your goal of developing experience and what you need to do in your environment and how you do that, you know, for application, for example, focus on back-end containerized Java applications, the core of the Kafka, you know, most externalized configuration dependence. And for the platform, in that case, we start a simple, linear, complex work in the progress, implement what's required step by step, balancing infrastructure and application concern. That is what you are doing for the platform and for the monitor operation and 24/7 support, recovery action, team backup. Okay. Next slide.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Plan the work.
Yeah. So Yvon shared about reaching the state. I think the main messages from the last slide is that we had to define from the start what was the end result and a series of principles, the one we saw just before, that are there to, I would say, align the common objective of the team and make clear that we always need a balance between, okay, developer, operation, quality, testing, etc. And it was very key to have this balance and focus from the start. You saw that we focused first on a back office application, which is already a lot of the perimeter. And it was key to have this step-by-step approach, minimizing the risk and focusing on producing the value of accelerating the developer experience. And in fact, this is what then we put in place in organizing the work in a transversal way. So, in terms of order, we had to define the dependencies between the various parts. So first the foundation, then the Kubernetes, and then the support tabs. And we only address monitoring and security just after, and documentation, even if it was done along the way, it was then very complemented once we have covered the various parts and then to go in operation. And then, yes, you can do. Take the yes. Transition, Yvon.
Yes, and requirements, how you do this, how you start your process to do that. You have a kickoff meeting with the engineers and architects to fund all the teams, you know, in that case, you give the all the teams the chance to talk, you know, and to a more visible architecture to that guys, you know. You define a core architecture, you know, to start the deployment of Kubernetes, you know, implementation of the core architecture, you use continuous integration to continuous delivery. In that case, in the first thing, you use the cloud objects to create cloud objects with Terraform. With Kubernetes feature, you use the Helm chart to install the supported application, you know, and continue after that, after you create the core base environment, you give the developer team access to the developer environment, you know, to start to do the things. After that, in the parallel tasks, you know, we continue to improve your environment. So you start tasks to the monitor, to backup, to disaster recovery, to integration with ITSM and external integration if you need, or for your own promised environment, and create some operators to help us to go your production ready. And after that, after you create that improvement, you know, you integrate your environment with your ITSM system, you know, and now you have one process together with the infrastructure team, you know, and now after you integrate with the ITSM, you jump to the production environment change, start the request from the production environment. Next slide, please. Okay. What your environment architecture? Today you have seven Kubernetes clusters, you know, five Kubernetes clusters for non-production environment, two Kubernetes clusters for production environment and in high availability states, you know. One clusters for the federation stuffs like Prometheus, Thanos, Vault, Consul, Elasticsearch as well. In the future, V2O, Argo CD, you know, and one cluster for continuous integration. To do that, the process, all steps for the continuous integration, we create a specific cluster to do that job, you know, with all applications you need in the continuous integration steps. Okay, so your environment has 7 clusters, you know. In the production clusters, we have our clusters in high availability process, okay? And for non-production clusters, in the stage in which you have clusters more equal with the productions. And for the sandbox, you have a cluster for just for the test, you know? The next slide, please. And what applications, what about your supported application architecture? How your clusters in the kickoff meeting you define what you monitor, how you monitor this, how you operate on your clusters, how you do the security stuff inside the Kubernetes, how you monitor and deliver some things inside the Kubernetes. So for all your clusters, you define as some default applications. In that case, you see applications in the security stuffs, monitor, delivery, tools in operation, service discovery. In that case, you are using, for example, Consul, some Kubernetes operators like the replicator or workload restarted, you know. For example, when you change some secret or config map in your environment, you create some Kubernetes applicator to restart the pod and read the service, the secret again, or config map, you know. You are using OpenFast to trigger some functions to automatize your environment, environments, you know, with specific tasks. And Litmus, you are using for cloud engineering to have a good integration and a good customization if you want, you know. And for backup, you are using Velero, so we are using that support application for all your environments, you know. And it's the default in the pipeline. You have one pipeline, you trigger all that support application. You can trigger individually each application if you want, but when you start, for example, Kubernetes clusters, you trigger one pipeline, in that pipeline, you trigger all support application you want to give a production ready Kubernetes cluster. Next slide, please. They organize to work. Now, Antonio, you talk more about how you do the things and how you do the management of all that tasks. Okay, Antoine, go ahead, please. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, yes, in terms of organization, so from the start, it was a transversal initiative. So, we worked with the various stakeholders, I would say, from more. I would say not directors, but head of and external managers, but up to the production people. So what we shared with them and we co-constructed the plan that Yvan was sharing. And we started an incremental and iterative approach collaboratively between, we have some teams that were really the developer of the end application, some people in between more platform engineering, and then really the operation team that should host the various applications. And from the start, we work in a small sprint of 2 weeks and with defining a monthly objective that then we started to expand to every 2 months objective. But at the start, it was really, I would say, a very granular approach we had. We started from zero and we had a big dynamic to set. And we also implemented some key rituals like the standard one, a daily kickoff meeting, a retrospective, a planning to really align all the resources and validate who will do what, at which time, at which level of effort.
Yeah. Yes.
Key point, I think, to say that it was really transversal in the various roles we had. So it goes from the software engineer to security also, and we had involvement of key people like security, infrastructure, and monitoring is very important to secure from the start this type of requirements and also get their help when we need to do some specific action like we did security hardening, etc. Before going live to also reinforce the trust in the platform with the various stakeholders. And we have also to convince the people that at the end of the day own the application and should defend them and align the choice of Kubernetes. So it's mainly the engineering team lead and tech lead that we should not forget in the journey, because they all have a power in this adoption. And if we just have a platform and no one believing in it or not having trust, we just a failure for the organization. So during our journey, we had really to iterate in maturity. So at first time, we focused heavily on the systematic process, on the rituals, but we had low visibility, a lack of estimation. It was really hard to know what we'll deliver, when, etc. Definition of done was okay, a draft, but we had to iterate a lot after to identify the different definition of done for the different type of task we had. And we had really frustration in the start, so a lot of late tasks, and because we were really iterating on the process and finding an organization that worked. Mm-hmm. Then we iterated step by step, but still maintaining a 2 weeks iteration. It allowed us to have an emerging visibility on what are we able to achieve right now, and so in the coming sprint. We started to have a much more robust templates per type of task, and to achieve more on-time delivery. And what we are doing right now to align this better is to improve even more the estimate with the type of poker planning and cards estimation. We are working on aligning even more the epics we are working through to the organization to really be crystal clear and aligning the value and what we are doing makes sense on the overall picture, and it's still solving concrete business problem, developer experience, etc. So always keep the mind on who we are working for and for which value and which problems. So in terms of working the plan, I shared a bit before the approach on exploration, tactical and strategic. So our first step was always a bit what we call a cold shower. Is we are happy because we reach result, but at the same time we discover a lot of things we still have to do. So at that time we are happy to have some application able to deliver until production with Kubernetes, because Kubernetes is all what is around Kubernetes: integration, externalization, Vault, service, logs, etc. So it was a hard journey to get there, full of surprise and frustration and some nights. We got a lot of surprise with different behavior, even with a set of testing we had with the production traffic. So we had a lot of alerts, but at the same time, a lot recovered by themselves due to the Kubernetes self-healing capabilities. So we had a lot of noise with operation team, etc. So we had to have a continuous improvement process from the start and avoid unnecessary noise there. We started to have some instability in some environment, but then you need to understand why. And then you discover you are lacking logs, or you say, oh, I need to do command line kubectl to understand what is working. But you say, okay, if I need to debug with command line, there is most probably an issue in my observability. So you start to say, okay, I'm missing things here in maturity, in understanding what is happening. We have some points we forget. Yvan shared with you the architecture with the dev environment. Mm-hmm. On the start, it was on the scheme, but we didn't focus extensively on it. But we saw it was really a missing piece for people to experiment and for us to also test some other version out of the production line of with the other environment up to production. And then you start to have other topic, concrete topics, is that you had your team, your core team that did the exploration phase and the tactical one. But then you have you start to communicate to the company what you have done and show results in a tech talk or stuff like that. Or you have a new guy that come in the team and ask you, what is Kubernetes? And so, I think I forget probably about some part on onboarding, training, etc. More broadly, in the organization, to say, okay, if I want to scale, I really need to address this with a real approach and investment. So I would say our first deployment was a bit with this image. Okay, but so this is why we did it on a limited scope for production. So it's a bit caricaturing this picture, because we managed to put in production an application that was working. And in the first slide, we shared it was the first type of application with a microservice type decoupled with Kafka. And we managed to produce real value for the customer in streamlining some specific flow of information. that previously were blocked with the batch process and stuff like that. So we are still, even if this image was more the back office part of IT, it still produced value and it was working on a 24/7 fashion. The next iteration, we fixed the first problem we have, alert, noise reduction, etc. We started to implement some standardization for all the applications because our idea was not to do 2 or 5 applications. It was to migrate and adopt the platform for all the engineering perimeter. So we're starting to address repeatability of the processes. So we started by dashboard because it's the key to understand and see what is happening. So there was dashboard both for platform teams to know what are the pods, what is happening, etc. But also standard dashboard for application to know the state, the status, and the KPI. We also started to put in place the mechanism to ensure transversal communication, so to have a support, and to then have also feedback on what's working, what's clear, what's not clear when using the platform. We set up the famous development cluster. We had also to start to address a point because we started to have much more workload of application and a lot of pods with autoscale, etc. And we had so to start to address capacity planning. So not only in say we need to cut costs, but also to say, do I have a real scaling capability? Does the scale down is working properly? Which metric should I use to handle the scaling, etc. So we had a lot of questions there to address and iterate. And we had to address the concrete part of onboarding and scaling the engineering part. So we set up a real training plan with external partners training on Kubernetes. We also did in-company session and training. We allocate time for people on a Friday afternoon, etc. to practice on the tool. On a Kubernetes platform, etc. We allocated a buddy to each new developer to be able to collaborate there. And we started to restructure our development wiki to have a step-by-step recipe for any developers that want to develop with Kubernetes, all the steps involved each time, trying to automate as much as possible, but at least to have a guide for step-by-step for developers to have, again, all the way of repeatability is a key to scale. We need strong foundation, in fact. And in terms of trust, and both for us and for the external teams, we did also a security hardening of the Kubernetes platform also, and we had a lot of stuff to be corrected there. But it was also a way to reinforce trust for people, and it's an important part to don't underestimate. What we have work after, and we have still a bit of that working today, is really on application governance, because in fact, we managed to have much more stronger foundation, but then the other part you need to structure is the design and to have repeatable design of application. So we invested there, and also on the bootstrap acceleration of the project, so remove all the boilerplate code generation, etc. As we had much more application that were converging, we invested also on a much more distributed tracing capability, so of standard of log, dashboarding, alerting, etc. So this is key to understand what is happening between the various applications because we were really scaling the number of pods. We also started to support much more better, I would say, visibility, observability of application. And this passed also through much more self-service on the monitoring and alerting part. So our goal and what we implemented is all infrastructure monitoring and dashboarding alerting should be standard and available by default. So if you have some pods that are unavailable, etc., you should have automated alert. No developer should specify new alert for that. And that way, they can focus on what is of more added value. So and we focus a lot on the business metrics and business dashboard for all the application. To reinforce the link with business and also to improve the reliability of the application. We are expanding Kubernetes also of other application perimeters than the back office we started with. We have structured the capacity planning, very important with the growth of the perimeter to keep management of what we are doing. And we have more move now to a repeatable process of onboarding and training of the developer. So hopefully in the coming months, all developers will know natively Kubernetes, I would say. But right now, in the ecosystem, we have a lot of people that know, that have been curious about, but people that really grasp all the bits up to the length chart, the deployment, etc. It's quite complicated. So we are seeing also a level of abstraction that are upcoming in the ecosystem to simplify this onboarding. But for us, it's still a bit require a bit of knowledge, and we also linked with the capacity planning support FinOps processes.
Yes.
So here, it for example some concrete deliverables and topic we have addressed. So on the left, it's it was a wiki we have at some point on all the good practices we have and where are all the standards. In addition to that, there is really a step-by-step recipe for deploying an application. We had also on the design part implemented the concept of whitelist and blacklist. So to say, okay, if the application is following all the whitelist part, you don't have any justification to say, etc., it's good normally. And we enrich it regularly with an internal community of practice. And to the contrary, there is a blacklist. So, and if you want to use something in the blacklist, you have really to explain why it, and we discuss. And sometimes we can find a better solution just by sharing and identifying, I would say, some counterintuitive design. And this is a good part to scale also, because like that, you can scale. Everything that is in the whitelist can scale and go directly to production. And all the rest requires a sanity check, I would say, in terms of design before proceeding with the implementation. On the organization, I will let Yvan share briefly what was the core changes on the various persona we had around Kubernetes.
Yes, that's right. So what developers need to learn, the first thing when you start developing the Kubernetes environment, you need to understand why the Kubernetes and how you can use the Kubernetes to do the things, you know, so it's more specific to understand. In our case, for example, by default, you enable the pod security policy will be deprecated in the newer versions, but you are always changed to the open policy agent, okay? Using network policies, some objects, so the developer guard needed to understand how the objects works inside the Kubernetes, you know? And for example, how you can create a Docker file or how the containerization works, you know? So for developing team to improve your day by day in Kubernetes stuff, you know, you need to learn Kubernetes, to learn container, you need to understand how you can configure your application or how you develop your application for the containerization stuff, you know, how you debug the things, né? So don't bother the DevOps team guys, you know, you need to understand how you debug and do troubleshooting inside the Kubernetes. So that is your challenge. And the first things in the when we start that project, your challenge is how you can, for example, give it to the developer team a good experience, you know. So a good experience coming from the developer team and coming from the DevOps team, okay? So that's why we want to develop need to understand to start to work in the Kubernetes environment. So, and what DevOps guys need to learn to start to work with Kubernetes and the cloud, you know, but more specifically Kubernetes, the DevOps guy. The DevOps guide needs to understand how Kubernetes work in high availability, how you can move the steps from one object to another object, so one cluster to another cluster, for example, develop the cluster to TA cluster or staging cluster to production cluster, how you code the things, how you can, for example, do the infrastructure as a code, or how, for example, the Kubernetes operator works, you know, because today, if you don't understand how the operator works, you know, you always use the simple applications, you know, so you need to understand the operator. Administer Kubernetes, so how you can, for example, configure the resources in the cloud, how you improve the resource or enable or disable some features, you know, how you test and deprecate the things. So to be a good Kubernetes guys, you know, you need to learn. And I think in all the teams, you have a senior and a junior guy. So For me, the same, I need you to share your knowledge with the junior guys and give the time to that guys study and learn, okay? So much I think the DevOps guy needs to be. And this is transversal stuff. So when you talk about the Kubernetes and all the applications in the Kubernetes orchestration, when you talk about transversal, talk more about the business and what the business expects in improvement and lead time, availability, scalability, costs, application components. You know, this is this transversal talk, you know, because the DevOps guys need to talk with the DevOps guys, you know, to talk more about how you can architect it and do the things inside the Kubernetes. So in the future, you know, develop some understand the big picture, learn the practice new skills, and testers can be more close with DevOps guys, you know, to understand how you can do more tests or cause engineer tests, for example, inside the Kubernetes, you know, and this is a transversal way. So the good things to be a production ready Kubernetes is you talk with the other teams, you know, that's the goal. You talk another teams, work together with another teams, you know, and you do the things together. Okay, so Jesus, you need to put in your mind when you talk about the Kubernetes and the two-way factor methodology, for example, you talk about it, the interchange communication.
Yeah. And to wrap up a bit, what did we achieve and some type of learnings for us during this journey? So I think a key message is we could have put a Kubernetes logo is that Kubernetes is only I think two messages. It's first, it's a platform we are building, so it must aim to specific persona and solve specific problem. And in our case, the business and developers and the infrastructure team are key stakeholders. And when defining the scope of implementing Kubernetes, I would say the scope is very large in what we should address from organizational topic, culture, skills and training, how to learn, etc. On top of a series of broad topics, not directly linked to engineering, development and the code only, security, quality assurance, observability. And it's a huge topic when implementing this type of platform. I would say that it's very important to have this in mind when starting this type of initiative because it's quite structuring investment over time. So I say keeping a big picture around Kubernetes is key. Here it's a bit to share what we have in terms of standard dashboard we were talking about to industrialize what we did in terms of, so we invested so standard, I would say, technical alerting, etc. But we also invested much more broadly with business metrics and alerting. And this is possible if we have a robust foundation and replicable standard. So this is what we achieved there with all the dashboard, so visible to have the team with automated alerting. And we implemented some key practices of such as the four golden signals of the SRE of Google, that type of stuff, very useful to have quickly a good overview of the health of services. And at the end of the day, did we achieve to accelerate and what we still have to do? And I think a key learning is that yes, but Kubernetes helped us to accelerate around the, in terms of, I would say, the capability we saw in the first part. But we still have a lot of topics to treat that are not directly linked to Kubernetes. So to be able to have first much more stability in our deploy and also be able to deploy out of a freeze period because we see that over here we have a lack of opportunities we are missing. So this is a bit the global capability dashboard we are following to measure if really our organization globally is able to deliver better. And there is a lot of topic around communication, organization, etc. In addition to a technical topic and Kubernetes, but I think it's very important to maintain this key picture in mind to verify if our implementation is bringing value at the end of the day to our capability. We have also on top of the number of deployment, a focus on the cycle time of developer. And this is for us is a key dashboard we are always following on the drill down to measure also the ratio of successful and unsuccessful builds. And the ratio of funnel, a bit like an e-commerce funnel, how many changes done are go up to production. And then the last important part is what is the cycle time on this. And everything we do should be at the service of improving the cycle time. so that people can make sure they are producing value. If not, they will tend to focus on technical things here and trying to improve technical matter. So right now we are able in 3 minutes to go up to production on the streamlined processes. But again, the key is not to do it once, is to do it in various fast feedback loop in different applications. So the key takeaways we can share today, and I think for me it's something to have always in mind. It's not a one-shot project, is have always the end result and objective in mind we want to do for the business and the users of the platform we are building. It's key. We can quickly get lost in a local KPI technical stuff and trying to do something more, and just it will be better like that. But at the end of the day, you just delay using some technologies. So it's quite key to focus on using end-to-end quickly. Adopting Kubernetes, we saw in the map, is providing a platform. So this is where it's important to have the vision of persona, services, self-service. And this is where after we need to have an organizational and change to address. Key part, I think, is I would say it's a bit buzzword and agile, etc. But start small is very key, and start small until going to goes to production in the start small quickly to validate your hypothesis. And the last point is more to remain, I would say, with hope can be useful, but you need to have a stakeholder with you, support, key influencer, and leaders to drive this until completion, because you will have setbacks, and we had setbacks, frustration, difficulties, and we never, I would say, let it go during the 2 years we needed to go to a really strong strategic deployment in production of Kubernetes. So I hope this sharing was interesting to you, and we are up to questions right now. Is there some?
Thanks very much, Ivan and Antoine. We have no questions yet. I hope people will type them, but I have some of for myself. So I saw that you were using Prometheus to gather metrics and so on. Are you using some kind of framework for Java to collect that, like Micrometer? How are you collecting those metrics?
Yeah, so we are using standard. We evaluated Micrometer, but we are always relying on standard of metrics with standard injectors. And then we use also, this is not on the collection part, but then we rely on Thanos for the long time archiving, where we are trying to do some ML to know if there are anomalies and stuff like that, but it's very preliminary. But yes, for the back office engineering parameter, yes, it's based on the open standard. Now we have a bit of challenge because we are opening Kubernetes to other applications, so guys with React and .NET and stuff like that. So we have here challenges to have, I would say, this is where standard, in addition to, I would say, the technical connector in our case in Java code, is very important to be able to have this structure logging transversally. And we have real challenges then is with non-in-house application, because we have some ERPs and external vendors. And when you ask, is there a logging and metrics connector, they tell you, what? No. So then we are a bit blind, if we want the end-to-end perspective on some areas of the business. But it's challenges. So right now in acquisition of vendor, we always look for standard logging and metrics connectors, but sometimes it's not available yet.
And are you using open tracing or open telemetry or planning to do so?
Yeah, we use that, because we are, we started without distributed tracing, but we said, okay, we'll use standard of open tracing, open API, etc., to at least have the standard from the start, and to then be able, when we add some specific layer afterwards, at least the foundation are there available and were followed from the start, and we don't have like 100 application to change, etc., and ask every developer to change everything.
So one last question. So which tool do you use for your deployment pipeline? So to deploy on Kubernetes directly?
So you want to answer, Yvan? We have GitLab, but we have other Helm, etc. involved. Yvan, I'll let you.
Yes. Today, you use GitLab CI to do the continuous delivery, but you already have an open project to move this to RagoCG, you do some research about how the best continuous development tools, you know. And for us, Zygo CG is the best for today. So we will start the project, already start in the progress stage to separate and split the continuous integration with continuous delivery. And today, we use the same tools, you know, GitLab CI, but in the future, I start to use the Zygo CG.
Okay. So what our time is up. So Ivan and Antoine, thanks very much for being here at JNation. I hope we can have you in future editions as well. And thanks very much and see you
thanks
soon.
Thanks a lot for the invitation. Yeah.
Thank you for the invitation.
Bye, to everyone.
Bye, Bruno. Thank you. Have a good one.